I want to say welcome to those of us who are here this morning.
Thank you.
God has been good to us, amen.
Amen.
And we thank God for that special item of music, amen.
Amen.
What a blessing to train the little ones to walk in the ways of the Lord, amen.
Amen.
You know, when Jesus walked upon the face of this earth, children loved to be in his company. They would climb and climb all over him. And many times he said, we must become like little children.
Amen.
If we had to enter into the kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen.
Our children don't really belong to us.
Lend to us.
They belong to God. Amen.
Amen.
They are loaned to us to be trained for his kingdom.
Amen.
What a blessing it is. I admire parents who have daughters. There is something very special about having a daughter, amen?
Yes.
And imagine taking her to the first prom, the first date. There is something special. In biblical times, when you had a son, then you were considered to be a man. Amen?
Amen.
But it's amazing when you have girls. Sure, Dad, you must be happy. Amen. We are all God's wonderful children.
Amen.
It's good to be a part of the family of God.
Amen.
I welcome those of us who are here this morning. And I trust that you will hear the message with understanding. Amen.
Amen.
Let us bow our heads as we pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we come before your throne of grace to give you thanks for being so good to us. Thank you, Lord, for your love and your mercy, for your grace, for your patience with us. And we, Lord, we pray that your presence will be felt in this place and in our lives. As we open your words upon our minds and give us understanding, may we learn something that will draw us closer to you and help us to be careful to give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. Speak to me, through me, and for me. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Cosmic coercion, historical coercion, customary coercion. One of these days I'm going to preach on that subject. But the word coercion means that which convinces us the most. When somebody has been coerced, it means that they have been convinced. And the message today has to do with convincing. And for those of you who love titles, have entitled the message, a tsunami warning. Sometimes you don't see it coming. As a matter of fact, until it is too late. And it travels at a tremendous speed unbeknown to you and I. A speed that is so amazing, it's like an iceberg. The mountain is beneath the water. You can only see the tip of it. And that makes it very dangerous. A tsunami warning. Now the scripture reading that was read in Revelation chapter 12, what led up to the scripture reading, we look at it from Revelation chapter 12. And the Bible says that there, this I believe is one of the most amazing passages of scripture in all of the Bible. When you talk about the great controversy, you read Revelation chapter 12. It gives you a view of the cosmic conflict, the great controversy, the battle that is going on from the very beginning of time to the very close of time in Revelation chapter 12. And the Bible says, you know, when God speaks to us, we need to listen, amen? Because the Bible is its own authority. And there appeared a great one in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon on her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried to a virgin birth and paid to be delivered. And there appeared another one in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 crowns upon his head, and his tail to the 3rd part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. And she brought for the man child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was called upon the God and to his throne. The Bible says that the woman fled into the wilderness where she had a place prepared of God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Now the scene changes. And the Bible says that there was war where? In heaven. Michael, the one who is like God, Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found anymore in heaven, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. What caused them to be cast out onto the earth? What caused the rebellion in heaven? There was a sudden deception unbeknown to the naked eye. It was like a tsunami warning, and when it came, it was eventually too late. Unbeknown to us, the battle that started in heaven. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, "Now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of the brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of the testimony, and the love of their lives unto the death. Therefore," is a concluding statement, "therefore rejoice in heavens, and he that dwell in them, woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. For the devil is come down unto you having what? Great wrath, because he knoweth he hath but a short time. So woe to us, but rejoice in heaven." Amen.
Amen.
Those who dwell in heaven, rejoice.
Amen.
Those of us who dwell on the earth, woe to the inhabitants of the earth. It's a sober warning. And when the dragon saw that he was cast out into the earth, now there were two casting out. Amen. When the dragon saw that he was cast out into the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man child. And to the woman were given 2 wings of a great eagle, that she might fly to a place where she is nourished for a time, times and half a time, from the face of the serpent. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as of a flood after the woman, that he might cause her to be carried away of the flood. And the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood, which the dragon cast out of his mouth. And verse 17 says, "And the dragon was wroth, angry with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the what? The commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ."
Amen.
Now this is a very sobering passage of scripture. It's pregnant with meaning. I'm just going to use one line of it. But there is so much here, you can spend an entire week just speaking on Revelation chapter 12. And there was war in heaven. How did war start in heaven? And you and I know the story. God made Lucifer, whose name means light bearer, as close as possible to himself without making him God.
Amen.
He was perfect when God created him. Amen.
Amen.
God placed in him something extra special. We are told on inspiration that when Lucifer would sing by himself, he could sing all the parts at the same time, and he would sing like an entire choir, all by himself. There's a difference between a Cessna and a 747. Amen. So he was sung like a 747 all by himself, like an entire choir. He was precious. All the precious jewels was a description of the qualities that he possessed. But he has lost that license. He cannot practice law anymore. Amen?
Amen.
He has lost that title. Lucifer is a very good name. But because of the bad connotation that is attached to his name, nobody wants to name their son Lucifer. His name has been changed to the devil, to Satan, that old serpent, the accuser of the brethren, the father of lies, and so on and so on. You and I have an enemy. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
And the devil is real.
Yes.
Believe you me, I used to talk to the devil. And the devil will never come and say, I'm the devil. He always uses an interpreter. Friend of mine, the devil is real, but greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Amen?
Amen.
He can only go so far as God allows him. But you and I are no match for the devil.
Never.
Amen?
Amen?
The devil uses cunning subtleness. And sin is so deceptive that when you are deceived, you don't even know that you are being deceived or that you have been deceived. That is the very nature of sin. It is so deceptive. And it has transpired down to earth. When he looked at the holy pair that God placed in the Garden of Eden, this was no ordinary plan. We are told that he went by himself, not entrusting this plan to the other angels that fell with him, but by himself. This was a master plan to deceive the human race.
Amen.
When he looked at the holy pair and he looked at the joy and the peace and the harmony that they enjoyed in that Edenic beauty, he shuddered that he would plunge them into despair. For a moment, he decided to change his mind. But the rest of the angels joined him and said, whatever your decision is, we're gonna stay with you. And he shrugged down the fear and decided to go forward. The devil masters his plans a deception when it comes to deceive God's children. You and I are no match for the devil. Eve knew better, but she thought that she could handle it by herself. Solomon, with all the wisdom he had, and you must have some wisdom in order to ask for wisdom. Amen? But the wisdom that he had initially could not be compared to the wisdom that God gave him. And the word that God blessed him with was just a bonus because he asked for wisdom. The foolish decisions he made, he began to trust in himself that he was wise enough. Eve thought that she was clever enough, that she was wise enough to handle it by herself. And many of God's children, many of us, we are tempted to think the same way. I can handle it. I can manage the disease. It's no threat to me because I'm a Seventh-day Adventist, I'm a child of God. Unbeknown to us, God allows certain things to come our way to see that we are futile and we are fragile. And we are not to depend one moment on ourselves, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen?
No other foundation. All on the ground is sinking sand. We need to build on the solid rock, the rock of Gibraltar, the immovable rock, Christ Jesus. Our feet need to be firmly planted on the rock.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Jesus is our foundation. The New Jerusalem has 12 foundations. A and the names of the apostles are on them. But the rest on the chief cornerstone, which is Christ himself. Because Peter means pebble, Petros, a movable stone. But upon this Petra, Jesus pointing to himself, upon this Petra, I will build my church.
Amen.
The church belongs to Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
But that's not my message this morning. My message is a tsunami warning. A tsunami warning. I turn your attention to the book of Acts. In case you don't know which book is that, that's the book of Acts. Amen? The book of Acts. God loves every single one of us. Amen? He loves us with an everlasting love. We pick it up at chapter 4, reading from verse 34 to 37. Neither was there any among them, Acts chapter 4, reading from verse 34 onwards. Neither was there any among them that lacked. For as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought them the prices of the things that were sold. And laid them down at the apostles' feet, and distribution was made unto every man according as he had need. And Joseph, who by the apostles was surnamed Barnabas, which is being interpreted the son of consolation, a Levite, and of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it, and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. So the Bible tells us that the early church, the reason why they were giving, they were courageous, they were in unity, they were at one, they were sharing, they attended to everybody's needs because they had been influenced by Jesus Christ, amen? And there was a transforming power that took place in their lives. And it could be seen in their lifestyle habits. They were giving, they attended to the needs of those who lacked. And Barnabas, who had land, sold it and brought the funds and laid it at the apostles' feet. Who was his name?
Barnabas.
He was a good man. He was a generous individual. He was kind. He was a giving person. Now go with me to Acts chapter 9, reading from verse 26. And when Saul was come to Jerusalem, Acts chapter 9, reading from verse 26. And when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he essayed to join himself to the disciples. But they were all afraid of him, and believed not that he was a disciple. Because before he was known as Saul the persecutor, there was a marvelous transformation that took place in his life. Amen? In Acts chapter 9 and verse 7, Luke records the story by saying, and they that were with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. It's talking about he was given the Saul's encounter on the Damascus Road. But in Acts 9:27, Paul was giving his own experience. And he says, and they that were with me saw indeed the light, but heard not the voice of him that spake to me. So Paul was giving his experience of his conversion. Was a marvelous conversion that took place in his life. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Now the word for here in Acts 9, 7, Acts 22, 9 is aqua phone. In the genitive case, it means to hear without understanding. In Revelation 1, 3, it says, blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written there, for the time is at hand. The word for here in Revelation 1, 3 is aqua phone. In the accusative case, it means to hear with understanding. So Paul heard a voice with understanding. The others that were with him heard a loud noise. Amen? So after leaving this service today, and somebody should ask you, well, what did Brother B spoke about? And you could not give an answer, it means you heard a loud noise. You need to hear with understanding, aquaphone.
Amen.
In the accusative case, amen.
Amen.
Blessing is he that readeth. Blessing pronounced upon those who hear with understanding.
Yes.
And a blessing is pronounced upon those who do what they hear. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
So even if an illiterate person have the scriptures read to them, they will be blessed.
Yes.
Amen. We need to read with intelligence. So I want you to pay attention to this message. It's a very subtle warning. A tsunami warning. So after his conversion, verse 26, as we read again, and when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he essayed to join himself to the disciples, and they were all afraid of him. I'm sure you and I would be the same way. Amen? And believe not that he was a disciple, because there was a bad connotation attached to his name. Saul the persecutor. Now, verse 27 says, but. The word but is a conjunctive injunction. The word but changes that which has gone before from that which is to come. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared unto them how he had seen the Lord in the way, and that he had spoken to him, and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. Barnabas, who was a good man, who was a wealthy man, who was generous, who was kind, he took Saul and brought him to the disciples and calmed their fears and their doubts.
Yes.
He was a man of courage. He was a man of good judgment. He was a man who was sincere. Man who you could depend on, amen? Mm-hmm. The disciples were scared. Barnabas took him, brought him to the apostles and calmed their fears and their doubts. Mm-hmm. He was somebody, what do you say?
Yes.
Amen. He was special. Acts chapter 11. Acts chapter 11. We're going to be reading from verse 19. Now we'll take it up from verse 22. When the gospel began to be broadcast and to spread in Phileas, in Cyprus, in Antioch, in Cyrene, to the Grecians, a great number believed. Great number believed and joined the church. We pick it up from verse 22. Then tidings of these things came unto the ears of the church which was in Jerusalem, and they sent for Barnabas that he should go as far as Antioch. Now, when the news came to Jerusalem that the church is growing in Antioch, they decided to send an ambassador from the church. Not of the apostles, but Barnabas. So Barnabas was sent to represent the church. He was sent to represent the general conference. So he was a man of influence. He was a man who knew the doctrines of the church. Amen. He was not just a good man, he was not just kind, he was not just generous, he was not just influential, he was not just brave, he was very educated, he was equipped with the word of God to represent the body of Christ to the only believers, amen?
Amen.
So the same for